So, in order to set the scene for why this video exists, I need to explain my Amazon import era.
Recently, I've developed the habit of checking international Amazon sites in order to hunt for dolls that are either unavailable or drastically more expensive on the UK site. And so far, I'd say it's been a fulfilling process. I got my number one Rainbow High doll, Slumber Party Robin Sterling, from Amazon Italy for a fraction of what the US site wanted, even including shipping costs. I got the G3 version of Frankie Stein from the US site months before they dropped in the UK, and for not much more than the UK would eventually price the dolls.
I don't think this method works for most doll purchases, since shipping adds a good £10 to £15 on top of everything. But if they didn't release a certain doll in the UK, it might be worthwhile to look on one of the international sites and see if you can get a better price.
My most recent hunt has been for the Shadow High Trunk Show set featuring the Ainsley doll, yet another product that MGA hasn't launched in the UK. And because I'm curious, I tend to do searches for not just Rainbow High, but lines like LOLOMG and Bratz. And in the suggested tab, I'd end up spotting other dolls like Mermaid's Mermaids, the Zombies 3 dolls that never got launched in the UK, Mermaid High, which also never got launched in the UK. You're sensing a theme here, right? But the one set of listings that stopped me in my tracks was a couple of the Wild Hearts Crew dolls, a doll line that I honestly forgot existed.
And that's weird, right? This doll line was kind of a big deal back in 2019.
They were the closest thing Mattel had done to a Monster High style line. Fashion packs, multiple body types, bold colours, a semi-edgy aesthetic. They'd gained quite a lot of positive reception despite a minimal launch and their unavailability in anywhere other than Northern and Central America. And oh yeah, I already had one of them.
Yeah, I got the Kenna Roswell doll a few years back from Amazon and just completely forgot.
So why exactly has this line had as little an impact as it's had? Well, I did some digging and found out close to everything I could possibly find out about this doll line, from fun development facts to speculation on why it ended.
I also bought the rest of the dolls from Amazon in the States. Yes, this was a mandatory part of the research.
So, grab your nearest portable cassette player, pop on your favourite vintage jean vest and roller skates, and dial your pizza obsession up to 11. It's time to do a doll autopsy on Wild Hearts Crew.
Hi everyone, I'm Ari Lynette, and welcome to the Ollieverse. I don't really feel I need to disclaim much in this video. This one's a bit more informative than it is opinion-based, though we will be getting into some theorizing, particularly towards the end. And this is where my one disclaimer comes in, and this is an important one. I will be speculating on why this doll line didn't do well, but it's gonna be exactly that. Speculation. I don't want to risk spreading any misinformation, so take all of these theories with a critical eye. Don't just treat them like fact, because they're just theories. From a tired gay with an animation degree and too much time on his hands. Okay, I think that's all I need to say. Let's start the shindig at the beginning, shall we? So let me set the scene. It's May 2019. What does the doll market look like?
Well, MGA isn't doing much in terms of full-scale fashion dolls at this point. It wouldn't be until July that they'd properly unveil their extensions to the LOL Surprise and Poopsie brands into full-scale fashion dolls. Meanwhile, Project MC Squared hasn't released new dolls since 2018, and Bratz's latest range was pretty much an online exclusive in most places. As far as Mattel goes, Monster High's gone, Ever After High's gone, and Enchantimals is holding a tea party on their joint burial ground. DC Superhero Girls just got rebooted, the Polly Pocket reboot is in its second year, plus they've took on the dolls for the recent She-Ra series. And of course, Barbie is about to turn 60 and is continuing her push into more inclusive dolls. Hasbro is making attempts at Disney princess dolls and miniature purple-haired Dove Camerons with printed-on leather jackets. Other companies are providing such innovations as Boxy Girls and Snap Stars.
Yeah, there isn't really an electrifying presence in the doll market.
So imagine the surprise when on May 15th, 2019, Mattel drops this little crumb on their socials. Celebrating those that wear their heart on their sleeves, the Wild Hearts Crew is a sisterhood of girls challenging everyone, everywhere, to hashtag dare to be different. Join the crew this July at Walmart stores across the US. Hashtag Wild Hearts Crew. Purple heart emoji, flame emoji, guitar emoji.
Yeah, so Mattel just announced a new doll line out of nowhere on their general Mattel-branded social media accounts.
They also dropped a press release talking more about the line. It discussed a launch event that was held in Palm Springs, the dolls having new body sculpts and articulation, and that they'd be in Walmart stores initially in the USA, with no word yet on an international release.
Before I go into the dolls themselves, I wanted to have a look into the line's development.
I'd heard that people who'd previously worked on the Monster High design team were working on Wild Hearts Crew, but I didn't know the specifics. So I did a little research and found some names with some help from an Instagram post from Garrett Sander. The line was co-created by Simi Cumes and Rebecca Shipman. Cumes is a design manager at Mattel who'd worked on My Mini Mixie Qs and the newest incarnation of Polly Pocket, while Shipman will be familiar to Monster High fans as one of the brand's principal designers and current head designer. We also have Jendae Smith as primary graphic designer, who'd also worked on some Monster High G2 lines, plus Mattel's senior packaging designer Siobhan Seen, Elena New, Nana Wang, Carol Hensley-Rodney, and Taylor J. Pierce were also involved in making the line. I probably missed a few other people, so I apologize for that.
So yeah, there's an eclectic mix of people involved in this project, many of which did have involvement in Monster High in one way or another.
By June and July, people would finally get to meet the crew when they started showing up in Walmart stores.
So let's meet them.
The five members of the Wild Hearts crew were announced in that original social media post with a name and an occupation each. Cori Cruz, the musician, Kenna Roswell, the photographer, Jacy Masters, the skater, Rallee Radmore, the dreamer, and Charlie Lake, the rocker. The dolls each come with some details on the back of the box and a little fold-out zine booklet to flesh out their characters more. It details what they're good at, what they need practice with, what they can't live without, what makes them different, and what's in their wild heart.
The box descriptions and booklets are really important because they end up being the only form of world building and media for this entire doll line.
So let's get into those descriptions, starting off with Cori Cruz, who's the musician of the group. She loves playing piano and working the DJ mixer, and she can't live without music. So much that she ends up getting lost in music, so much that her wild heart is full of music.
Yeah, they really bury Cori in this one interest and don't give her much else at all to work with.
Then we have Kenna Roswell, who's the crew's resident photographer. Naturally, that means she can't live without her camera, and she struggles to take things at face value. She believes there's more to the world than meets the eye, and wants to see it all. Her wild heart wants to see the truth about everything. Next up is Jacy Masters, who's listed as a skater, specifically a roller skater. She loves anything classic and retro, she's a history buff, and wants to teach her friends how to roller skate. Just don't expect her to be able to sing well or watch scary movies. She also loves vintage clothes and considers herself a bundle of sass and class all rolled into one. Our next character, Rallee Radmore, is simply listed as Dreamer, so you might be curious to what this actually means. Well, she's good at fixing things, loves playing guitar, and has an issue with being on time. She's never believed that she shouldn't do something because girls aren't supposed to. But most importantly, she loves pizza. She frequently soliloquizes about her love for pizza in both her booklet and unbox bio, whether it's pizza history, the top pizzerias from Naples to Rome, or exactly the right baking times.
Initially, I and many people thought it was kind of weird for Rallee to have such an intense pizza obsession, but honestly, in hindsight, I think the autism in me respects it.
You hone in on that special interest, sister. Lastly, we have Charlie Lake, who's the rocker of the group. And while she loves rock concerts and being loud, her bios definitely focus more on her love for animals. She'll always help an animal or a friend in need, and while she's not the best at being organized, she's confident in being strong and compassionate at the same time. Another cool fact about Charlie that you won't find in her booklet or doll box description is that co-creator Simi Cumes intended Charlie to be a reflection of modern Native American teens, both to add new representation to the media landscape and to honor her family's own indigenous heritage.
That's a really cool tidbit that I only learned about this year, and I think more people ought to know about it.
The dolls come in pretty easy to open boxes, not too different from classic Monster High. Just a classic-ass cardboard box with a backing you pull out at the top, a couple of plastic ties around the body, and voila, your child is free from captivity. I'll just quickly note here that a few of these boxes got seriously beat up in transit. Surprisingly, Charlie's and Cori's boxes got here unscathed, but Jacy's box was crushed in this weird way, and Rallee's had big shreds of plastic broken off its window box.
I mean, they did come all the way from the US in a standard brown Amazon paper bag. So, I'm not surprised that the box has got a little jacked up, at least.
The line not only has its own unique body mold, but even manages to have some variation in there with two separate sculpts. The quote-unquote standard body is what I describe as a more shapely, stylized take on the current Barbie sculpt, with a more pronounced hourglass shape, wider thighs and calves, and larger heads, though slightly smaller than what you get with Monster High. The standard body doesn't feel revolutionary. Like I said, it's not that far off from Barbie, just with shapelier elements performance, reminiscent of Ever After High and DC Superhero Girls, and a height closer to G3 Frankenstein than the one from G1. This body is used on the Rallee, Kenna, Cori, and Charlie dolls. The Jacy doll, however, features her own unique sculpt. The body used on Jacy is a broader, curvier take on this first body sculpt. While it's easy to draw a parallel between this doll and the introduction of the curvy Barbie body in 2016, Jacy's is definitely more stylized in the same style of that standard Wild Hearts crew body. The more shapely limbs and torso are great even on the standard sculpt, but it adds so much character to the Jacy sculpt in particular. Also, both bodies feature molded on bras and underwear. Some people love that, some people hate that. Personally, I'm indifferent towards it. All five of the dolls feature articulation points at the neck, shoulders, elbows, wrists, hips, and knees. The articulation is sturdy, if not a little stiff at times. The elbows, knees, and shoulder joints are pretty great, but the wrist joints tend to be the weak link here. They don't have the fluidity of Monster High articulation, but they're nowhere near the hellscape of Mattel's gappy joints era, and they can all kind of stand on their own if you angle the knees right. The faces are pretty cute, and definitely a step up from the Barbies Mattel was putting out around this time. When you look at these dolls together, you immediately get the impression that they all love a clumpy lash. These eyes do share a bit of kinship with Monster High, with the distinct irises, feathered brows, and honestly really cool makeup choices. The head molds are marked 2018 and have some neat little features like Jacy's dimples and I believe a slight smirk in Rallee's mold, but aren't specific enough to limit their custom potential.
The hair on these dolls is mid. I'm sorry if that's a bit of a weak descriptor, but that's the best way I could describe it.
It definitely doesn't sink to anywhere near the lows of early 2010s MGA polypropylene, but it doesn't hold a candle to Serrano, even the nylon used on Rainbow High. If I had to guess a fiber for these, I'd lean towards a higher grade polypropylene, possibly a lower grade nylon.
It's not bad, it's not amazing, it's mid.
Cori's is the best out of the crew. The fiber works really well with that hair texture. I don't plan on taking down the ponytails on any of these, but out of the loose haired dolls, the rooting is pretty impressive. Though often the hair on these girls is very choppy, particularly with Kenna. Rallee has a shaved side, which isn't flocked but instead painted with additional molded details, while Cori features sculpted cornrows as part of her head sculpt, similar to the original DC superhero girls Bumblebee. The outfits are a mixed bag. Even before I got the whole set, I could see some of Mattel's quieter cost-cutting methods used with these outfits. Scratchy printed on denim, some stray raw edges, the thinnest faux vinyl known to doll kind. Nothing really comparable to what they were doing in early Monster High or even G3. There are thankfully a good amount of separate pieces. Jacy and Charlie's vests are both separate from the t-shirts, both Kenna's black tank and orchid mesh top are separate. Honestly, this line does a great job avoiding the all-in-one sewn together outfits that have plagued Mattel's lines in the past decade. There are also some genuinely cool and interesting pieces with neat features. Charlie's skirt has this really cool deliberate fraying. Both Cori's jumpsuit and jacket are really well made. And eagle-eyed Monster High fans might even spot some nods to the Freaky Fabulous franchise, with skulls on Jacy's vest, Rallee's lapel, and Kenna's jeans. Also, all of the shoes have these hexagonal holes in the bottom of each sole, in a similar way to how Bratz shoes have these holes. Initially, I thought Jacy was the exception since her skates didn't have these holes, until I sussed out that the skates are separate pieces? Yeah, shoes can go from roller skates to regular sneakers, the latter of which do have those holes at the bottom. The accessories that come with these dolls are few, but mostly effective. The coolest is almost definitely Cori's portable cassette player, though the headphones don't really sit in her head right once you untie them from her head. Rallee's steampunk goggles are a close second. You have a couple of repurposed Barbie pieces, such as this love necklace and frankly useless little red purse on Jacy, a pink passport era Barbie camera on Kenna, plus some Monster High earrings and a guitar-shaped bag from Ever After High on Charlie. I'm not too sure what the ratio of new to reused pieces is, since I don't know the provenance of all the pieces. For example, I couldn't find Cori's earrings on a past Barbie release, though I swear they came from one. At some point, I had to stop scrambling through old Mattel releases and just accept I'd never truly know that ratio. Something I do know is that multiple fashion packs were produced for this line. Wild Hearts crew launched with a grand total of 8 fashion and accessory packs, 4 four-piece sets, and 4 8-piece sets. The four-piece sets included a t-shirt, a pair of sunglasses, a sheet of temporary tattoos, and either a pair of shoes, skateboard or hoverboard, while the eight-piece set included a jacket or sweater, a pair of shoes, a sheet of temporary tattoos, and multiple plastic accessories, such as glasses, purses, headbands, and tech gear. I don't own any of these packs, so I can't speak to their quality, but there are some cool-looking pieces in there, like the fuzzy leopard print coat from the Cool Things set, the little orange pizza earrings from the Punky Pizza Party set, plus just everything from the Retro Hero set, which is just adorable. In all honesty, the fact that these even exist is quite the feat, considering the amount of doll lines that have never had fashion packs out. Like, OMG and Ever After High have never had fashion packs, and Monster High went a good few years in late stage G1 with no fashion pack releases.
Doll-wise, one last interesting fact I wanted to bring up was the case assortments and how they were distributed, particularly at launch.
I believe these dolls were shipped in individual cases because not all of these dolls landed in stores at the same time. Initially, it was just Kenna and Cori popping up together, then Jacy, and then later on Charlie, and finally Rallee.
I remember a few people whose initial favourite was Rallee waiting for her to finally come onto shelves. Or maybe that was just me, I don't know.
Once they've released, they were received positively by collectors, particularly those who enjoyed Monster High in the past, and got a wide, albeit somewhat passive following in the community. But as quickly as they hit the shelves, it seemed like they were just as quickly getting discounted. For a supposedly edgy line with ties to Monster High's design team and even nods to the brand itself through their fashions, Wild Hearts Crew still ended up circling the clearance bin by the start of 2020.
So, what happened? There are a lot of rumours and speculation about why Wild Hearts Crew didn't succeed. Again, none of this is confirmed, so don't just take all of these bits of info and run with them. When I looked into these threads of people speculating about the line's failure, I looked at each of them with a critical eye, and I'd encourage that you do the same. Personally, I always thought that the reason why Wild Hearts Crew didn't get a second wave was because Mattel didn't give them a chance to succeed. And in some ways, I still think that.
They gave these dolls no real promotion, made them Walmart exclusive of all places, didn't make a web series or any accompanying media.
Heck, they didn't even have a dedicated social media account.
You know how Monster High, Ever After High, Enchantimals, etc., they all have their own Instagram pages? Yeah, the Wild Hearts Crew Instagram page wasn't even technically an official Mattel page, it was run by their design team. The promotion that Mattel did do for the line was on their own Mattel branded accounts, where they posed every single brand and product under the Mattel umbrella, from Jurassic World to Pictionary to Barbie. That made it really easy for Wild Hearts Crew to get buried and not stand out as its own brand. Look at most of Mattel's big doll launches. Monster High had a multi-channel launch strategy so successful, they put together a team of executives with the sole job of creating more brands under the Monster High model. Ever After High got a similar launch. Enchantimals and Cave Club got big spots at Toy Fair pre-release. Later in the year, Creatable World would get an entire Time article for their launch, ending up on UK shelves 2 days after their US launch. The brand's lack of expansion to international markets was another sign that Mattel clearly didn't see this brand as anything but an isolated release.
And sure, some of us more savvy collectors could resort to importing the dolls from overseas, but that's a privilege that not every collector has. And even if that was an option, you're much more likely to buy a doll if it's easily accessible to you, like if you can just pick it up off a shelf, than if you have to jump through hoops to get it. I imagine there's a pretty big drop-off point there.
I did want to look at some other theories on the line not succeeding, so I had a look on Reddit and found a real mix of responses.
Everyone hated them because Mattel had just killed Monster High. As cool as they were, the wound was too damned fresh at the time.
Yeah, I don't agree with this one. I certainly don't remember it being that popular of a sentiment.
I feel like enough people were able to see that Monster High wasn't coming back at that time, at least in its current or past form. From what I could see, a lot of people were just happy to see alternative style dolls with full articulation on the market again.
If anything, I feel like Mattel's falling quality around this time was a bigger factor than just them killing Monster High.
Wild Hearts Crew was one of Mattel's better lines around this time, but it still fell into some of the pitfalls of Mattel's cheapening standard of quality.
They fulfilled their destiny of crushing the second, or was that a third? wave of fresh dolls and were promptly forgotten.
Okay, this is a really interesting one.
If you don't know about the fresh dolls, they're a smaller doll line focused primarily on black and multi-ethnic fashion dolls, and they've been quite successful despite not having the resources of big companies like Mattel.
So Wild Arts Crew came out pretty much nowhere with that announcement in May, and then in around September, the fresh dolls reveals a sneak preview of their upcoming dolls, and people had things to say.
The fresh dolls at that point had only really touched natural hair colors, so to see a doll with blue hair not too different to Kenna, a doll with a red high ponytail like Jacy, and a doll with a purple frohawk like Cori, people called copy almost instantly. There were people saying the fresh dolls had copied Wild Hearts Crew, but also a decent amount of people speculating that Mattel could have took in development ideas from the fresh dolls to put into Wild Hearts Crew in order to dampen the brand's goodwill. Allegedly, this was a practice that did happen during the company's efforts to compete against Bratz back in the day, so there's not a 0% chance of this happening, but still, it's a theory at best.
I don't think the fresh dolls would have stole from Mattel, but I also don't think that Mattel would have gone so hard on such a small brand in a non-litigious context.
For all the good that the fresh dolls has achieved, they've never been successful to the point Bratz was, where Mattel was actively threatened by their success.
And as far as doll development timelines go, I'm also gonna have to lean towards a no, but none of us know the full truth.
I'm pretty sure the reason for lack of new toys, and even lack of advertisements for said toys, is the stupid COVID-19 pandemic.
I get what you're saying, but this is Mattel we're talking about. This is one of the biggest toy companies on the planet. And while COVID will have definitely had an impact on sales and production and import stuff, I kind of feel like they'd already given up on Wild Hearts Crew at that point.
Like, I'm pretty sure most people saw the writing on the wall by January of 2020 and were well into their OMG phases at that point. Not to mention, Rainbow High launched smack bang in the middle of the pandemic and still managed to thrive.
Also, I know this one's a bit more of a speculative statement, but if Enchantimals could survive the coronavirus, I'm pretty sure Wild Hearts Crew would have done just fine.
Manufacturers might decide to try out new lines to see what feedback comes back. Similar to computer companies letting people download and work or play around with a beta version of a new product. That way, they get a wider range of feedback that then is used for deciding on new lines or changes to existing lines.
In theory, that sounds plausible, but isn't that what focus groups are for?
And Mattel heavily used focus groups during the development of Barbie's 2016 revamp, Creatable World, the original Monster High, and the G3 relaunch.
I feel like if any testing was involved, it wouldn't have been the launch itself.
Though I do think it could have been a trial run for some of the ideas implemented with G3 of Monster High, like the bigger bodies and improved diversity, but massive emphasis on the could.
Before I move on to the next response, I want to take a brief tangent in how Mattel handles doll line longevity. I wonder if there's a more brief way of saying that.
So one thing I've noticed about Mattel's doll lines is that they all have a pretty similar pattern of longevity, or at least have a few different categories. For example, MGA has the tendency to cut the cord on doll lines when the sales aren't showing, like with Bratzilla's Novi Stars or the 2015 Bratz. Whereas Mattel is far more willing to drag lines out to the end and change them up, like with Monster High and Ever After High's reboots, or Diva Stars shifting away from robot dolls after the success of Bratz. There's also a variant to this drag it out model, which I like to call the international method, zeroing in on overseas markets like My Scene from 2009 to 2011, and more recently with Enchantimals. The one big exception to this rule with Mattel is probably Flavors. They were pushed hard during launch, and though they didn't do well in sales or reception, they still had 3 seasons worth of new releases. Even lines like Creatable World and Cuckoo Harajuku, which had one big launch of dolls, did have some additional releases scattered afterwards. The only other one-wave-and-done doll line I can recall from Mattel was their She-Ra line, and that was an IP. Wild Hearts Crew is wholly original. Unless that fresh doll stuff is true, no, we're not going there.
Mattel doesn't really do one-and-done doll lines, especially with original properties. Which brings me to the last bits of Reddit speculation, and the ones that I think are likely closest to the truth.
They weren't meant to last. They were a single-year flanker brand to maintain Mattel's shelf space share while other product came to market.
Now, this is the point where it finally all clicked.
A doll line that got little to no promotion, dropped as a Walmart exclusive with no official social media account or tie-in material.
Mattel wouldn't need to promote the line if it was only going to last one season.
Now, I don't know how store shelf space works or how Mattel usually handles this stuff, but I imagine that Mattel already had a large amount of shelf space, and with LOL Surprise furiously expanding and MGA expanding their fashion doll range once more, I do think Mattel would have wanted to keep as much hold onto that shelf space as possible.
And while the most natural option would be to have some new Walmart exclusive Barbie range, there might have been one other incentive of having a new Mattel doll line on the shelves.
WHC was a passion project for its lead designer and something she had wanted to do for a while before she got the opportunity to.
This line was a big life goal for Simi Cumes, and I'm not aware of Rebecca Shipman having created a brand with Mattel before Wild Horse Crew, so I can absolutely see this as a possibility. And because passion projects are a risk and might not always build to full franchises, if Mattel did need a single year brand, it would make sense to let the designers do something fun for the year with no risk of commitment. Maybe as a favor for how they screwed up Monster High?
Again, I don't know if this was the case and I probably never will, but if it was the case, I hope the designers knew it was just going to be a one-year thing.
It would suck to be able to do your passion project and then find out the corporate overlords were never planning on carrying it on beyond the air. If this was an upfront deal, it would probably be the nicest end result for everyone involved. Let me have hope, okay? So why did this line really fail? Like, what is the concrete, undisputable explanation for why Wild Hearts Crew didn't succeed beyond one wave of dolls? There isn't a 100% proven official reason to why this line failed, and I don't know if we'll ever really get one. As far as I can see, both Simi Cumes and Rebecca Shipman still work for Mattel, with the latter being the lead designer for G3 of Monster High. Judging from Cumes' Instagram, she still looks fondly on Wild Hearts Crew, and I can only hope that's the same with the other people who worked on the brand. Right now, the doll world is dominated by Rainbow High and OMG, with Monster High following behind them, and Barbie having entered its biggest year in a long time with a theatrical movie on the horizon. In the midst of all that, it seems like the vast majority of collectors have forgotten about Wild Hearts Crew.
Heck, even I forgot about them, despite having the Kenna doll in my cabinet just behind my collection of Star Darlings.
And I can't even be surprised. A doll line with only one range of releases, no tie-in media, no real international release. Of course this was gonna fall by the wayside compared to all the lines that have narrative content and multiple years of releases and actual cultural impact.
But if this video proves anything, I hope that it proves that even a doll line intended potentially as just a one-year affair can still have a lot of passion behind it.
Whether it's the addition of body diversity, the much-needed representation for Native American teenagers, or even just the fun designs with leather jackets and bright colors. Whatever the legacy of this line ends up being, Wild Hearts Crew is worth remembering. Even if it's just for Rallee's pizza obsession.
Thank you for watching this video. I know this is a new format for me, but even with this first one, I feel like this doll autopsy format has a lot of potential behind it. So let me know if you'd want to see this kind of video on any other discontinued doll lines. I know I might have mentioned a couple randomly in the video, so just let me know. I would like to make videos other than tier lists. As always, if you like this video, give it a like. Come chat with me in the comments. Let me know if you have any of these dolls, if you forgot that this line exists, if you didn't know this line existed at all, if seeing this video on the suggested tab made you remember them. And if you want to see more doll content from me, feel free to subscribe to the channel and follow me on Instagram at OlliverseDolls, where I'll let you know all of the good. All of that and more will be in the description. So thank you again for watching. And from me and the Pog, who is currently stacked on top of books because Short King, have a rockin' day. 'Fore I move on to the next response, I want to take a brief tangent in how Mattel handles dong... Not... Fuck off. That is not the turning point we're making in this video.
We get there and I'm like, where's the pizza?